This is a presentation of WKNO Memphis.
Hast thou given the horse strength? Hast thou clothed his neck with thunder? He swalloweth the ground with fierceness and rage. Through his mane and tail the high wind sings, fanning the hares who wave like feathered wings. He is fire and wind transformed into poetic majesty, a sonnet of beauty and grace, a rhapsody of power and motion. His strength and beauty captivates us. His magnificence tantalizes the mind with wonder and amazement. He fills our dreams with fanciful images of riding through clouds, of finding unicorns in magical forests, of taming wild mustangs. And God took a handful of southerly wind, blew his breath over it, and created the horse. The affinity often begins at childhood. Hearts are captured, dreams are tantalized, and desires are fueled by the delightful fantasies so often portrayed in books and movies. For ages, horses have been viewed as loyal, loving friends, always there when needed, special animals, seemingly gifted with the power of reasoning and the ability to save us from harm. Horse owners can quickly become attached to their horses. After all, it's a relationship that dates back to our earliest ancestors. Ancient Greek, Roman, Oriental art vividly depicts an animal with arched neck and flared nostrils, a proud, high-stepping horse, an image that's been fixed in the mind of man since our earliest beginnings. In early America, horse breeders began bringing this picture to life in the American Saddlebred horse. The American saddle horse gained fame as a breed during the Civil War, 1861 to 1865. Saddlebred served as the mounts of many famous generals. Lee on Traveler, Grant on Cincinnati, Sherman rode Lexington, and Stonewall Jackson's mount was Little Sorrel. Because most Confederate horses were privately owned, General Grant's order at Lee's surrender allowed the men to keep their horses, which may very well have saved the breed. Today, the rewards of owning American saddlebred horses are many and are often connected with a sense of pride and achievement. Much of what we derive from owning horses, regardless of the breed, can be attributed to the closeness of teamwork, knowing what the other is thinking and feeling, and then reacting accordingly. With time and practice, these reactions become spontaneous, somewhat second nature. And from that comes the bonding, a closeness that blends horse and rider into one. However, there is something we must never forget. The horse is still an animal. And even though this belief of shared trust and undying loyalty is quite beautiful, it can make one vulnerable to unexpected accidents. The horse is powerful, majestic, and demanding of our love and our respect.
A horse reverts very easily. We call them domesticated animals, but they're not really. They're really wild animals that have a thin veneer of civilization. It requires constant attention. It's not like a dog that is domesticated and we train it and you can leave the dog alone and it'll come to you years later. You know? A horse is much different, much wilder. That was one of the big surprises of horses to me, how wild they are, both as a baby. If you're by the baby when it's born, as I try to be, it'll try and get to you as the first closest object. Within 2 days, it's shy of human beings, having bonded to the mother, and it's shy. From then on, it's a process of trying to bridge that gap with association and then all the the aids that we use, the aids of reins, of spurs, and of our voice, and our legs. And it's continuous. It has to be continuous training. Otherwise, there'll be some slippage right down to going back to the wild. This is Sultan's great day. This is the horse that I saw in a stall and fell in love with 5 years ago. I didn't know what he was. I just knew that it was something that I would love to have. And Donna Moore owned him, essentially, and I bought him. We didn't think about breeding at the time, but he was bred to be a great breeding horse. But it's a chance, it's a gamble, a breeding horse. And so we started to breed him after he'd won two world championships, harness championships. We bred him, and his babies emerged far more beautiful than we could have imagined. And they've continued to be beautiful. He's a breeding horse, and he's dangerous. A stallion, a domesticated stallion. We have him by a thin leather rope, but in the wild, they're as wild as protective as any lion or tiger. And they have all those instincts. So we're very, very careful with him because his instincts are to breed and to protect. But when they're gelded, they are the most beautiful and tractable of animals. American Saddlebreds are the ideal riding horse. They're they do so many things. They jump. They've been world champion jumpers. They're dressage horses. And of course, they work in the disciplines that we have, which is walk, trot, and racking. And they're beautiful just to look at. And that's what we do a lot of, looking at their babies.
People around the world recognize William Shatner as a superstar for his legendary role as Captain Kirk in the Star Trek adventures. But there's another side to William Shatner that's equally as fascinating. His true life role as an accomplished horseman and serious breeder of American saddlebred horses. We wanted spontaneity and a realistic look at what compels people into the horse business, into horse show competition, and into horse ownership in general. So we went behind the scenes with Bill and his lovely wife, Marcy, at their Belle, Reve farm in Lexington, Kentucky. Everyone was geared up for competition at the Lexington Junior League Horse Show, a prestigious annual event that draws only the finest in American saddlebred horses.
What, sweetheart? The great part of this farm. This is a business, but it's a pleasure to run a business like this. The competition is great, and I love it. But the other magnificent part of owning horses is breeding horses. Here is a broodmare, and a horse that we compete on. And also, she gives us babies when she can. And so we breed this horse to that black stallion, and 11 months later, emerges something, diving out of the mother's womb. That's the most remarkable thing. The babies come with their feet forward and their heads laid on their feet in a diving position. And the instant they're out of the bag, they open their eyes and they're staggering around. And I've delivered babies, and it brings you to tears. And then to watch them grow and to watch the whole process as baby is born to when you can get on their backs. I compete in two disciplines, saddlebreds and reining horses. I have a couple of reining horses in California, and You know, you go through life with various thrills. The first job, the first child, I mean, they're deep, abiding thrills as you go through your life. At a certain point, the thrills begin to lessen. You don't have the first child. You don't have the competition of the job if you're no longer competing as hard to make it as you were as a young man. So that thrill can be lost, but it isn't lost in competition. The thrill of competing on these horses is the thrill of winning and losing, which you do a lot more of than winning. And losing is a bitter pill to swallow if you expect to win. And to be constantly in the mode of, I want to win and I lost, what can I do about it, is not usual for people. And it's life-giving in that you're sensitized to all these horses, for example, this being this particular sport, you're sensitized to these horses to the degree of, can I win on this horse? Will this horse and I be a partnership? And that kind of anticipation is rare to have in life, and it is a blessing to be able to do it. That's the thrill of the competition.
Hey, gentlemen, come down to the walk, if you would please. Down to the walk now, please. Back to the walk.
Watch your traffic now.
Now reverse, please.
Come on, slide your bits.
You reverse,
slide your bits.
I'll ask you to show your saddlebreds and the park trucks. Last number 25.
Good. Straight on the rail.
Entry owned by Mr. and Mrs. William Shatner of Los Angeles. And William Shatner is the rider in third place.
Same. And be a normal career of London, Kentucky, and New York, this is place.
Good going. I just tell them you haven't been here, you just flew in.
How you feel about it, Bill?
How do I feel about the ride?
Yeah.
Well, I wish I. There's no substitute for a blue ribbon.
Yeah, all right, sure. And,
you're always disappointed no matter what it is. On the other hand, if I were to be kind to myself, I'd say I was doing something else for 4 months and not riding.
Yeah.
But I don't want to be kind to myself.
Yeah. And had much time to work the horse.
I was a mixed bag of success and failure. I did better than could have been expected of me, than people expected of me, and didn't do as well as I expected of me. I would like to have won. I felt I could have won if I hadn't made the mistakes I made.
The thrill of competing, of being in that show ring under a judge's scrutiny, of being watched by fellow competitors or by a faceless crowd that's evaluating you, your horse, and your performance. It's all part of the competition. It can precipitate self-doubt while it cultivates self-confidence, a situation that's common to horse show competitors, as common as the butterflies that flutter in the pit of your stomach, and as inevitable as tunnel vision, an intense focus that isolates you, that allows you to see only your horse, what's directly in front of you, hearing only the rapid pounding of your heart, the rhythm of your horse's breathing, and the voice over the loudspeaker. And then, there are expectations, what you expect of yourself and of your horse, expectations of friends and family. We can come out of it a winner and make everyone proud. Or the opposite can happen and turn it into an humbling experience.
Olivier.
Either way, it taxes the nerves and heightens the senses.
Olivier is shown by Melissa Moore, with Mr. and Mrs. William Shatner of Los Angeles, California. Congratulations to Olivier.
I don't get nervous showing as people know nervousness. Appearing in front of people has been my lot in life, all my life. So I've made a fool of myself so many times, I'm accustomed. I've grown accustomed to my foolishness. That isn't what worries me. What worries me is, will I be worthy of the horse? You see, Donna Moore and the breedings we have are of such excellence that it's an honor to be a part of it. Whether I am capable of living up to the capacity of the horse and the trainer is the worry, and especially when riding new horses and the thrill of the newness of something like Tuesday night. So that's the worry. If I'm confident that I will be able to do as well as I'm capable of and as well as and show the horse to his maximum, then it's only the thrill of riding and competition, and I'm not worried. But the worry is good.
There is anxiety, and there is hope. It's an arena of mixed emotions. Horse and rider must be in sync, working together as a team in perfect harmony. There's a great deal of work involved in showing horses, and even more to consider if you want to be a winner. It takes time and patience, proper training and practice, a lot of hard work and dedication, but above all, it takes relentless determination and an unrequited love for horses.
He loves people.
Hey, oh, look at this. She
just come
with me.
Yeah.
She can come with me.
Come on, darling.
Love her, Belle.
Yeah, she's, look at this. She's just, she won't, look at this. Is this one? She won't go. She just wants to be petted. Come on, baby. Is that, I want to stay? Our riding horses come in two categories. One that walk, trots, and canters with such precision and such grace, the horse is called a walk-trot horse. Other horses that have a more easy way of going, a more ambling way of going, are made into racking horses. They walk, trot, and canter, and then there's a slow version and a fast version of the same gait. It's called a slow gait and a rack, but it's really the same gait. One's faster than the other. The rack is faster than the slow gait. And that they're taught, something new is taught to them 6 months after they're under saddle. A whole new gait. You shove them off balance a little bit, and they single foot, which is, some other breeds call it a single foot. And they do a four beat gait. And finally, they get used to where you give them a cue, this cue, and they immediately do this ambling gait, which is primarily that of the saddlebred, which is called the rack. The rack done at speed is really one of the most exciting things you'll see a horse do.
And now rack on and let them rack.
This bit that's in their mouth is a very harsh device if it's used harshly, and is a very guiding device if it's used correctly. In somebody's hands who is not aware and hasn't got the skill, that piece of metal can tear the lip. But done in experienced hands, this bit is joggled like this. It's just that much pressure. That's all we need. Horses are placed on the bit. They lean a little bit on it. They're taken off the bit so that this thing, they just come up to it, get off, and everything in between leaning on it and being absolutely off it, there are trainers do various things. They force the horse up onto the bit and then back him off a little bit. The amount of pressure, it's as delicate as a surgeon's hands, putting them on or off the bit. Donna puts them just on the bit slightly so that they can lean a little bit on it. But some of these hot horses will take with their teeth, grab onto it, and a horse's jaw is very, very powerful. And they will lean on the bit and grab it with their teeth, and it's our learned expertise to joggle that bit and say, get off it, gently. If you do it too hard, the horse's head comes up, and you lose the leverage of the bit. Now the horse's head is in the air, and he's able to run off. So you've got to be very, very careful that you don't get into that situation where a horse learns to raise its head You lose the leverage of the bit, and the horse takes off, and you have no, it's like driving a car with no steering and no brakes. And it all is in your hands. Horse has a life of 20 to 30 years, lives from 20 to 30 years, and in those periods of time, they go through various stages. We here breed our horses in the spring, the 11-month gestation period. They foal around March, April, May, and June. Late foal is in July. And then they go for a year and a half in our fields, just growing and eating the green grass, the Kentucky bluegrass with all its calcium. They're grained and fed additional hay. And then at the age of two, they come in here and they start to be trained. First they're lunged on a line, so they get used to being handled. Then lines are put through, a bit is put in their mouth. Lines are put through the bit, and they're long-lined. Somebody stands in the center of those rings at each end of this arena and tries to teach them how to guide and how to rate. And then a saddle is put on them 90 days later, and somebody gets on their back very slowly. They're walked around. Then after they're taught to walk, trot, and canter, on some of these horses, we put the additional gait, which is called a rack. Then at three, they start their training like this here. At 3 years of age, four, they're in competition with trainers, and at five, we amateurs begin to ride them. And then they go on for a competitive life anywhere up to 15 years of age. Then usually they're retired, and people who don't know how to ride as well can take them because now this horse is completely broke and is usually very easy to ride. And so from 15 to 20, 25 years of age, a lovely horse for somebody is available that was once a competition horse. What's happening here is this horse is being exhibited for the gentleman in the red cap who could possibly buy the horse. Now, this is the other part of the horse business. Raising the horses, training the horses, riding the horses is one thing. Now comes the thrill of selling a horse. Will he buy or will he not? Will the horse show? You have one chance to show this horse. That man's going to make a decision based on what he sees about this horse. This horse now has to be presented as you would any fine object. But it's alive. It has a mind of its own. Now, take a look at this horse. This is a young horse. She's been ridden five or six times. This is a magnificent baby. That's my wife, Marcy. Come here, sweetie. Both of us. Come here. You're on camera.
This is not right.
This is my wife, Marcy. She's
hello.
My partner. Hello. Hello out there.
Well, we're a little wet this morning.
She's my partner in this business. She mostly charms the people who buy.
Oh, is that what I do?
That's her job.
Let's see. And the horses?
And I ride the horses.
He's lying. Maybe I am charming. It's a beautiful filly here.
Ridden five or six times. And what they're looking at now is the promise. What is the promise of this horse? Will this horse grow up to be a great competition horse? Now he's gonna look at him. Come on along. We'll go try and get closer. I'll ask him what he thought of the horse. What do you think, Bob?
I like this one, yeah.
You like her?
Yes, yes. Always have.
What do you like about her?
Pardon me?
She's pretty. She's got a really different. She's not like that. The field is a baby.
Okay.
Yeah, no, she's elegant, isn't she?
He is something else.
That's a gorgeous face.
See, she's young. She's like an adolescent child. So you look at an adolescent and say, oh, isn't that a beautiful adolescent? Well, I wonder what kind of a beautiful woman she will be. Well, look at the elegance of this. Look at the head. Look at the neck. Now, her body isn't fully shaped out yet. She's awkward. But look at the elegance of this neck. You just know that, like a ballet dancer, she'll come out of her shoulders. Her shoulders, her chest is slim. She'll fill out there, you know. She'll grow taller. She's only two. They grow until the age of five. She'll be twice as much the horse. And yet, what she has now is so marvelous that the promise of what she can be is all there. And yet, they're as delicate as flowers. They can be ruined as quickly as flowers in the wrong hands. Somebody not treating this horse right now, treating this horse correctly now, can ruin the horse, and it will never be a show horse. Thank you, Kim. This horse's name is Miss O'Hare. She's a broodmare. I bought her at an auction. I bid on her. And a lot of people were after her because she is a full sister to what is arguably the greatest saddlebred that ever lived, who was a world champion, is now at stud. His name is Skywatch, and this is
a champion Imperator who is retired here in the Kentucky Horse Park and lives in the Hall of Champions, perhaps the greatest five-gated gelding of all time. He was the world's grand champion for 4 years.
Skywatch, a name that will endure in the annals of saddlebred history. And before him, Imperator, an extraordinary gelding whose dynamic presence in the show ring brought spectators to the peak of excitement. It wasn't that long ago when one of the greatest competitions of all time took place, a sporting event that impassioned people to a level comparable to that of fans at the Super Bowl or the World Series. It was the ultimate confrontation. Two of the greatest saddlebreds that ever lived, Skywatch and Imperator, head-to-head in legendary competition, both after the same world championship title. It was an event to remember. The great Imperator, he stole our hearts by giving us his soul in the show ring. And Skywatch, now retired to stud where breeders perpetuate their dreams, dreams of the ultimate performer. Perhaps someday there will be another Skywatch or Imperator, a prodigy that may even surpass our greatest expectations, and thus the pursuit of perfection, to breed the ultimate athlete, a goal that challenges all breeds of horses. And what better way to meet that challenge than with the American Saddlebred.